Hey guys, I'm vigneshwar-poojar and I have been working in the field of user experience from around 3 to 3.5 years. One of the routine complaints about Indian products is that they lack good user experience. People often say that it's not good enough. It's not as intuitive as the user experience provided by global brands. And most of the time we keep on stating the same thing, that it's not good, it's not intuitive, it sucks, it's not like Apple. So we do not have clear cut ways to measure what makes user experience good, better, or at least something which would satisfy the target audience group. So today I'm going to explain you about two of the most commonly used methods to evaluate the usability of a product. I'm skipping through the pluralist walkthrough, which involves what you say usability experts, the product managers, the developers. These are the two things which can be done in the development phase and pre-release phases, or even for a user review kind of stuff. Okay, the first one is cognitive walkthrough. The best part about cognitive walkthrough is it's a combination of a formal method with something which comes very naturally to all of us. It can be called as a role-playing kind of thing, where you imagine yourself to be the end user and check if the product meets the needs of the user. In this format, first thing what we have to do is define the tasks for the product. If it is a cab booking thing, what is the task? Main task is to book a cab at given point of time and from destination to source. And then there would be subtasks like checking which route would be easier, or if you want to reserve it, or you want to book it for, what do you say, regular repeated intervals. So first you define the task, then you use filters to see what are the subtasks involved, which subtasks would be performed more routinely, which would be the subtasks which would be needed only when the user is stuck while doing what he wants to do. So to put in simple words, cognitive walkthrough is something where you feel that you are an end user and see if you can understand what the product is doing for you. Yeah, cognitive walkthrough is all about asking yourself 4 questions about the product. When I say product, you divide it into tasks and subtasks and check it for all the smaller modules if they can satisfy the 4 questions which I'm asking you next. First one would be, will the user try to achieve the right effect? If he is trying to book the cab, would he know that the product gives him sufficient interfaces to do it upfront? Or should he have explored, go through the menus, check where it is, and then go through this? So what is the amount of cognitive load you are putting on the user's mind? So each thought the user has to put to use your task or your project is kind of shows that you haven't put enough thoughts into it, or the designer hasn't put enough thoughts to design the product so that the user ends up thinking of what to do, where to do it, how to do it. So the first thing is that, is it meeting his, what is it, desired goal, the right effect over there? This is the first question. Then you ask the second question to yourself: does the user notice the correct action is available? Few days back, I was doing a speculative work for yatra.com, and then I realized that there was a section called offers, but then it was more like a banner ad being played in a slideshow than saying that, look, here is offer, go and grab it, go and take it. So that wasn't evident. Although the action was available there, it wasn't visually shown to the user that this is the action you have to perform. It was more like, see, this is a menu card, you have to choose what you want to do, rather than saying them, this is something which you should give a try at. So that's the first question. Second question is that, is the right task being performed there? Second thing, is it what is it, available, or can the user feel that it is available on the screen? Yeah, the third thing would be like, will the user associate the correct action with the effect to be achieved? There might be a perfect solution for user's problem on the screen. It might be very much visible to him, but does it convey to him that it is something which will solve his problem? Or is it that you have worded it in more of a business jargon term where he doesn't know what he is going to do it, what he has to do with it? Okay, there are many examples over here. Like, most of the time, maybe on a flight booking thing, user gets a button saying the show flights, or there are multiple flights. But maybe if you had termed it as like book flight or book ticket, it would make more sense to his mindset, what he is going through. For him, it would be like, okay, I have to go from Bangalore to Mumbai, let me book a ticket. But if you are saying them, okay, we have 30 flights available, you can choose the airlines and all, that's the secondary thought which comes to him, which airline should I choose? First thing which would come to him is like, let me book the ticket, let me check if there is any ticket available on that particular day between those two, source and destination. So it becomes very much important that the words, the terminologies you use, the way it is depicted matches the user's mindset at that given point of time. And maybe creating personas prior to designing would help to evaluate what would be right kind of terminology to tell to the user, rather than saying that, okay, this is the database we have, these are the tables we had, let us use the same terminology over there, that user will figure it out. Okay. This is the fourth thing which most of us tend to forget while we evaluate a app or a website. We often think that apps or website design is a collection of screenshots. And while working within a design team or a product team, that's the way it is actually shown to a evaluator or a manager for that purpose. We never see that what is the status of the system and not the look and feel of the design. The screens, although follow a flow, it is very important to let the user know where he is in the flow of the process which he is following. Does it give him enough feedback to ensure him that he has achieved what he wanted to achieve? Or does it give him enough indication to cross-check that has he made any mistakes? Once I go to booking a flight, and next step would be making a payment, it is very important to display at least in a line saying that this is the route you have booked for on this date. Okay, this might be followed in most of the Indian sites and Indian apps, but most of the first timers or the people who start designing as a, what do you say, a secondary task to their web development skills, forget giving the feedback to the user at every given point of time. See, it becomes very important for a person who is not very much used to the computer or the IT era. If he doesn't know where he is, he panics. If he doesn't know that he has booked the right route, he's not sure that he has to make a payment. If he doesn't know that this would be his next step of making payment, that's where the buttons like proceed to payment or like book tickets make more sense than just giving a next option and that a status bar on the top saying that, okay, these were the four tasks, two tasks have been completed, you are on the third task, there is one more task remaining. He doesn't feel secure enough to perform the fourth task. If he knows the fourth task is the electronic transaction of my cash, while he's doing the third task, he will be a little more careful about what is the procedure he has to follow upfront or in the immediate task, rather than bringing the fourth task while he has no idea whether he can use his credit card or whatever, and he just thinks that I can book it now and see what happens later on. So providing the feedback of the system status and providing the feedback to the user that, right, you have done the right things in the previous steps, so let's go on, move forward. So that becomes an important thing, showing the system flow to the user along with the beautiful, interactive, intuitive screens, is an important aspect to keep the user in good trust. Okay, these were the four cognitive questions which are often done by peer reviews in the design team. And it's always advised not to have a manager or someone superior to the designers to go through cognitive walkthrough, because cognitive walkthrough has been designed to make the designs more efficient and not to evaluate them. So the whole purpose of using the cognitive walkthrough is keeping yourself as an audience or the end user, seeing that end user needs are met, seeing that end user would identify what he has to do and he can do it with maximum ease. The problem which would arise when a manager or someone superior or a client would go through your design, if you have not gone through cognitive walkthrough, that it becomes more of a judgmental, where there would be a need to improve your designs a lot in the macro details, and someone would pick up a fault in your design and then you focus on that rather than focus in a holistic way of, okay, is this making sense to the user? So first of the things which we advised in our team was like, let all the three people review the fourth person's design. Not as a co-designer or a teammate or having our egos, just thinking that would it make sense if I was using it as an end user? Would it make sense to me if I had to book a flight ticket? Would it make sense to me if I had to order a book from Flipkart? So everyone goes through that, but the problem arises if you don't go through this set of questions would be like, you get too personal while evaluating, because you are using it as an end user. If I'm evaluating Flipkart's website as an end user, my focus would go to the section of Flipkart which has desired products which appeal to me. But if I go through the set of this cognitive walkthrough question, it becomes a little impersonal. At the same time, the focus is on seeing that the usability and does it make sense to the user. That should be the bottom line while you are going through cognitive walkthrough. Yeah, you can ask now.
So this cognitive walkthrough, is it suggested to be done as a presentation to your manager?
No, that's what I'm saying.
So
it's
a presentation, you should not bring it up to your manager as, like, you know, imagine you're the user.
Don't do it. Because for a manager, there are multiple other things he has to deal with. Does it make sense to his clients? Does it make sense to the time he has allotted to the process? This should be basically more of self-appraisal or a peer appraisal. Why it is important is that you will get to know that you are, obviously in a team there would be people having different viewpoints. So it's like you get it assessed by your teammates, then it's fine. But while getting assessed by teammates, you should assure that he's not acting like your manager. That would be a waste of time altogether. Okay, the second one is Neilson's heuristic evaluation. This was proposed by Neilson and Norman's team, and this is something which can be used pre-release day. Cognitive walkthrough is what you do for the first cut or the second cut of the design. Neilson's heuristic evaluation, you can do it just prior to release, or maybe when the design team is convinced that it has done a good design. Few of the things would be overlapping with cognitive walkthrough, but that's the beauty of it. You check it again. Yeah, visibility of system status, showing user where he is. One of the problems which we had while designing mobile apps for content providers was that they wanted their brand name on each of the screens, on the top bar. But it on a smaller screen, it makes more sense to have category header as a header for the screen rather than having your media name on the top of it. Because the user would know, okay, I'm in this section of the tree, I have to move back to check something else. Or this is what is relevant to it. Although it is apparent and you expect a pro user to know what he is doing, it's always better to let him keep a system status on the top of the screen or somewhere in the top half of the screen. It is true with all the e-commerce sites or content sites or any interaction sites, Gmail, you should be telling the user if his mail has been sent, if it has been saved as draft. It's not something which would be shown as a screen to a evaluator, but it is one of the system things which has to be shown. Okay. Second thing is the match between system and the real world. As I told, the terminologies would make a lot more sense to an end user if it is more relevant to the task he is performing, if it is more relevant to things he is doing. Just for example, if it is like purchase a book rather than buy the product, it would be more intuitive to the end user. He knows he had to purchase a book and he sees a purchase book button, he clicks on it. But if it's buy product, it takes a second for him to translate it into, okay, this is my product and I'm buying it. So the whole funda of what you say interaction design is to reduce the load on the user's mind and let the computer do it for the user. So yeah, one of the primary goals of technology is the same thing: reduce the manpower used and utilize the facilities which the technologies provide you. Technology or the computer can remember things. Technology or computer can check through the vocabulary and see which one matches to what are the synonyms and antonyms and all those kind of things. Make use of it. Use as much as real world. Think yourself as a salesperson and how would you have dealt with the customer. Okay, if you are at the reception counter, what would be the kind of words you would be using with the end user? Would you be telling him, okay, sir, buy the product, or would you say, purchase a book? This is the book available over there. So those kind of things, removing generic things like product or flights and using more task-specific words like book a ticket or purchase a book kind of eases the user experience. Second thing is user control and freedom. This is one of the things which most of Indian sites and Indian websites apps are not doing as of now. The designer decides or the product team decides what is the flow of the application. How should he buy a book? So the present flow of Flipkart would be like you go to a category or you go to the discount section and then buy a book and then go through the transaction thing. What if I just want to buy a book upfront? There would be a procedure like you click on a book if it is available there, or go through search and go buy a book. Or what if I do not know what kind of book I want to buy but have a rough idea? I can again go through search or go through the categories and browse it. What if I just want to keep a book that I am interested in and buy it, maybe when time permits? So then I can keep it in wish list, or I can just keep it in the basket and buy it later kind of thing. So there would be more than one way of transaction. There would be more than one way the user would use the same application at different point of time. So creating personas, defining user tasks in multiple ways becomes a necessity. It's not always a single direction thing. It's not always I know that I want to go to Mumbai. Maybe I'm just looking for a holiday offer. So having a holiday package and a flight ticket separately, or having flight separately and flight plus hotels as a separate category, makes sense, because user, you should not assume this is what user would do. There would be 3 to 4 or maybe 5 to 6 ways a user want to use a single thing in different ways. Booking a flight tickets for different reasons perhaps, or making a journey maybe like say only one way or round trip, or maybe going to multiple cities and then coming back to the same destination. There might be more than one thing. So while doing it, while brainstorming it, we should come up with as many personas as possible and check if the application gives enough freedom for the user to do it, or is application imposing a single way as a more prominent way, and if it is doing so, is it sensible? Is that single way follows the Pareto principle, like it is used 80% of time and the other 5 are just used 20% of time? Then yeah, right. Keep it ahead and keep the second things as a secondary navigation or secondary way of checking if it's available. But always keep in mind, do not impose anything on the user unless you have data to support it. Unless your analytics say this is the only way the user have been using it and your business needs them to use it that way, then fine. Do not give freedom. But see if there is a possibility of exploring if user can be given freedom and user can control things according to his wish, then see if the system is providing that to him.
Are there any websites which are leveraging this user control?
One would be Flipkart, as I told you. There are multiple ways I can purchase a single book. I can book it today, I can book it few days later, keep it in wish list, or I can search books which are similar to that, which I do not know if what book I am buying. I just want to buy a personality enhancement book and I search it, there are categories, or even if the book title doesn't match, is not in my mind, I write it, describe it in a line or two, it lists the books which are relevant to me, so it gives me that a little bit of control on what kind of things I want to buy and how I want to buy. Few book websites, I would not like to name them, do not give me that freedom. I just have to know before buying it. I cannot explore the options of checking the books which would interest me. And like suggestion based on my previous purchases also helps me some.
Like going to
a normal bookstore and seeing that I want this book or seeing that if there is any book which would interest me, rather than making a commitment that I would buy this and book by so and so. Or maybe I know the title of the book, but I would also like to see if there are any cheaper editions available. If not a hardcover one, the paperback one, if it is available. Or if there is a book available only for India, Bangladesh, Nepal, that category, a cheaper one. Yeah, it gives me that option. Yeah, consistency and standards is one of the most important things. Is the design consistent throughout its system? If it is not consistent, is it for a reason or is it just that it hasn't been given enough thought? Clear Trip does it. The home page is different. The moment you move into booking a flight or booking a ticket, the screen structure changes. A top bar arises and you see where you are going, the status is shown, the hotels are shown and all those kind of things. Whereas in the homepage, they have more of a boxy structure where you choose which is the task you want to perform. But that is consistent with the user's thinking. Once he has decided what he has to do, that doesn't, taking a decision that whether he has to book a ticket by train or bus or flight, if once it has been taken, the same set of options do not have the equal amount of weightage which they had in the first screen. So they move as a smaller buttons on the top bar. So see if it is consistent either with the user expectations or with the theme design. Second thing, standards, match the standards. If it is for web, make sure that it is matching the web conventions. Make sure if it is on Android, it has Android style. If it is on iOS, it has iOS style. For icon, which has a transparent background and just a coffee mug. But most of the people who design apps from iOS to Android make a mistake of keeping the icon as a rectangular box, which is the iOS standard. But on iPhone, it looks good because everything else is a rectangular icon, not rectangular, square icon, and it shows you like a grid. On an Android phone, a transparent icon would make more sense because default Android applications have a transparent background and they look like, stickers pasted on my screen. So one more rectangular in the midst of other Android icons doesn't look well. It looks like boxy. But on iOS, it looks good. So see where for what you are doing. There are no right ways and wrong ways, but if you follow the standards, you will at least help the user to relate to what you are doing because he knows how the other apps work, so he can relate to your app. And then there is a chance of your app being rejected by the reviewers, Apple or Google. So if you are following the standards, that eases a lot of things. Error prevention, One of the things which is skipped during a evaluation of a product, because you are assuming the best case possible most of the time, because there is a crunch of timeline for evaluation. So see if there would be a high probability of first time user or regular user making a mistake. If I am booking a flight from Mumbai to Bangalore, there is a good possibility that I would have ended up booking from Mumbai to Bangalore instead of Bangalore to Mumbai. It's just a from and to, if I'm not used to it, your interface, and it differs a little from the other player's interface, I might make a mistake, or I might just make a mistake of not giving enough thought to the design. It's not user's responsibility to understand the design. That should be first thing. It's our responsibility to understand the user. Okay, so make sure that if there is an error being performed, user should be in a way to be informed that there has been error done and he can correct it. Yatra does it. It gives you option to change the flights. It gives you option to change the cities. Even after you have booked and you have reached like prepayment phase. So yeah, give him an option to correct or prevent errors. Yeah, recognition rather than recall. One of the things which we all understand is that users' primary goal is not to use our application, it is to do with something else. And asking him to remember everything, yeah, 5 minutes. Asking him to remember everything would be a waste of his time and his thing. Whereas the computer or the information architect, facilities available, can remember things. So one of the major trends these days is to remove the login account from email and password to Facebook login, because it is assumed that most of the users have Facebook accounts and they remember their Facebook passwords, or at least they have logged into the Facebook application on their devices, and just giving a login through Facebook solves a lot of problem for them, because they don't have to create another account, remember the password, and while creating password is one of the worst user experience thing which has ever been created. You are expected to give a password which cannot be remembered easily. You have to add a special character, you have to add a numeral, and then they expect you to remember it throughout your life. And they expect you to have a password which is not similar to other passwords, or similar to your name, and so on and so forth. Yeah, flexibility and efficiency of use. This is something like, for the first few times I would be using a certain flow through HU my task, but later on, if I'm a regular user, I should be, Paytm, for example, does it to some extent. Like if I give my mobile number first time, they ask me to log in and all those stuff. But the second time I give, they give me indicative plans. Okay, you have been recharging your 3G through our portal. These are the 3G plans available, or this is the range of 3G recharges you have been doing. This is the best option available. They give it. So it reduces my task from choosing a plan, doing this, so on and so forth. The system learns how I interact with it. So it should optimize the user's time. It should be efficient. The content is great. He's willing to spend time on the content and not your website. So the lesser number of words you use, the better it is. On Make My Trip, they do not explain what the task is. They just use it. Book ticket from to. There are some other websites which say from destination source kind of thing. It kind of takes out the focus from the functionality to your design. Design should always be at background. It should not be taking more amount of users' mind space than it is required. The lesser it is, the better it is. Help users recognize, diagnose, and recover from errors. Is your design good enough for him to know if he is doing something wrong or if he is on the right space, and ask him to recorrect whenever he goes wrong? Yeah, help and documentation. Maybe most of us have heard that a perfectly well designed product should not have a help guide. It might be true, but always provide a help and documentation thing, because it's more of lifeguard for a user. If he's stuck in something very critical and you are just relying on your great design skills for him to sort out the things. It's not the right way. Or just have a help document, maybe a small one, maybe a concise one, maybe an interactive kind of thing, maybe a slide, but have a help and documentation. If it is not there, no matter how great your design is, there is a lot of chances that people will feel left out from your thing. Okay, thank you. My name is Vigneshwar. You can reach me at Twitter. Any questions? Cool. Okay.
Can we rely on analytics to make decisions?
Yeah, you can rely on analytics. The problem with analytics is that you get analytics only for phase two. For something which you are designing from scratch, it's difficult to do that. And second thing with analytics, even while evaluating analytics, like Flurry gives you data when the user are using it, what users are not using it. But then, again, you need to know how to leverage the analytical content given to you. Why is it that people are not using it? Is it that they don't require, or is it that they didn't realize that it's important? So for second phase, analytics plays a huge role. But for the first basic scratch design, you need to depend on the design rules or the goals of a good design to see if you are making sense. Any more questions?
And market research will also help in phase one. So you show them current existing applications,
yeah,
see what they don't like, and then try and design something around those issues.
Yeah, the problem with the market analysis is that you do not know if they like it or don't like it. If I'm designing a cab booking service, I see Ola Cab's site, I decide, oh, this is a good design, this is a bad feature in Ola Cabs. But I'm not sure because I don't have analytics of Ola Cabs. Or I go through the reviews, the user reviews, and I decide, oh, people didn't like it. It's good, it's a directive to you. But then you cannot be sure of it unless you own the analytics or you own the product. So phase one, market analysis is something which comes pre-phase one to understand what kind of things are there. It reduces a lot of work on your part. You realize these are the consistent features used throughout, say, four or five competitors. You list them down. Then you add your own unique selling point and mix it around and give it to them. So, yeah, there are two parts to the design, user experience. One is product design, which has market analysis and what you say, feature things and all those things. The other part is interaction design, where you need to have more quantifiable ways to say, this makes sense, this doesn't make sense. So that's
so
the way.
Product design, try to use market research. For UI design, try to keep it unique and don't look at anything else.
Not really. For product design, look at market. It's like you are creating or directing a film. You see four films, you know this kind of films are going on. You know what idea is in your mind, you direct a film. Yeah, that is the story of a film. But then for screenplay, you see what is the science behind it. Okay, this the first person point of view makes sense for this kind of scenes. That is something which has been established in the industry. There's nothing to be great and innovative about it, but it is about being sane and sensible when it comes to interaction design. Any more questions?
What do you think about A/B
testing? A/B testing is cool when you have a huge amount of user base. When you are in a early stage startup or your project is more of an enterprise-based thing, you have just around 1,000 users using it, and nearly all the 1,000 users might have the same mindset, they would respond to you in a
critical. I mean, that's what it is, right, to test if it works or not.
No, if you have to expand it later on, it gets difficult. There are two things with A/B testing. It's good if you have a diverse, sample space. The second thing would be that if you are targeting at a homogeneous thing and you go for A/B testing, more or less you will find half of your customer unsatisfied with you. The other half would be satisfied.
But we'll know that.
Yeah, you will know that. If you want to test it, you can do it. But don't take the risk unless, that feature is so much of, value add on to your thing. Do not remove something which is very important to the user and say that, okay, we are in testing phase, we just wanted to confirm if it makes sense to you. Use the things if it is more like interaction flow, you do not know the screen would look good this way or would look good that way, and you just want to experiment it, do it on a small focused thing. A-B testing takes, and when it comes to mobiles, for native application, it's not as easy as it is on web. Only when the sample space is diverse and you have enough freedom to do it, if you know that you have gained trust of the end user and you can play with him and realize what is good, go for it. Otherwise, it takes you take a risk where you can lead half of your customer base really pissed off with you, thinking that it is not working the way I wish to. Facebook does it multiple times, and in a company of in a cubicle of 10 to 12 people, at least 3 or 4 of us would be cursing, because only on our timeline those changes would be reflected. Everyone would have
the feel. So. At least what I think is, if you don't have a lot of users, then it's better, because you will piss off less people.
Less people, yeah. Yeah. If you have a lot of users, you have a security that, what is that? Comfort level that. Yeah, or you know that it's not going back, you change it back, the other half, other 9 people console these 3 people, said it's fine, man, it works well now, they have removed that feature, that kind of thing. Any more questions? Thank you.